joining. Thank you for arriving on time. The first thing Mary said to me when she arrived was that I know your 6:30 means 7. And she was right. So this evening is special in many ways. We are celebrating the very auspicious appearance, the birthday of Sri Chaitanya, in the same week that the Christian world is going to be celebrating Easter, which is tomorrow, and the next few days. And I want to begin by really setting the context of what this evening is about. But before I do that, I just want to kind of especially welcome some guests in the audience. I'd like to begin by welcoming Narendra Vagela, the Baptist Swami Narayan, and a member of the Leicester Council of Faiths. I'd like to welcome Denham Kite, who is the interim head at Krishnavati. And I'd like to welcome the staff. Thank you. Thank you very much. And a very warm and special welcome to Mary Lawson. Mary has been principal of Krishnavati. And I'd like to welcome Sean Lawson. So the appearance of Chaitanya, what does that mean for us? Yesterday was that very special day, the full moon day, where we came together to celebrate with the joyous chanting of Lord Krishna's names. And I think this is one of the very special reasons that we celebrate the birthday of Lord Chaitanya. 5,000 years ago, we know that Lord Krishna appeared, and within his appearance, he taught the Bhagavad Gita. And within the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna is teaching the supreme idea of bhakti, or devotion. And in many places, for example, he says, always think of me, become my devotee, offer your worship unto me, offer your homage unto me. Later on, he says, I, the Supreme Lord, can only be known by devotional service. But then there is a very interesting account that after Krishna left this world and entered back into his spiritual kingdom, that we find him reflecting on the teachings he has left in the Bhagavad Gita, and almost reflecting on these teachings in a very sad way. In a way where he's reflecting, in a way where he's feeling deep emotion for the people within this material world. And as he sits reflecting on this, even to the point of tears welling in his eyes, and him considering, well, I left the message of the Bhagavad Gita. Very highfalutin philosophy, indications of devotion, but I feel that there is a gap. I feel that people need to be shown, people need to be educated, people need to be guided into how to actually live and practice the devotion that I'm speaking about in Bhagavad Gita. So as he is thinking in this way, as he is contemplating this, and deep love for the people of the material world, that's all of us, is deepening. It is already deep in the heart of Krishna, but as it's deepening, you okay then? Good. Krishna makes a commitment to all of us, he makes a commitment to this world, to appear, not in his supreme majestic form as the Supreme Lord, but to appear in a very humble form as a devotee, as somebody who is devoted, as somebody who wants to live and practice and experience the love for Krishna. And that appearance is the appearance of Sri Chaitanya. And Sri Chaitanya appeared 500 years ago in West Bengal. And at that time, West Bengal was known to be the seat of learning, to be the seat of knowledge in India. And what Chaitanya did was to teach the essence of this devotional practice that Lord Krishna spoke about. Because the principle of his teaching is that if the heart of every living being sits this pure love for God, deep within the heart of all of us sits this pure love for God, and that this human form of life is a rare opportunity for us to revive, to come in touch with, and to live and experience this pure love for God. So in exhibiting, in living, in sharing, in teaching the practice of experiencing pure love of God, there are many stories, and you may hear a few this evening about Chaitanya and his sharing of pure love for Krishna. But at one point, Chaitanya made a very bold statement, which until recently many people thought to be an over-glorification. Many people thought, is it metaphorical? Is there a hidden message in this statement? And the statement that Chaitanya made, that a day will come when all over the world, in every town, in every village, people will embrace, and people will come together from all different backgrounds to glorify and chant the holy names of Krishna. And I say, until recently, this statement of Chaitanya, which is 500 years old, wasn't really or truly realized. But His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada, and the lineage of spiritual teachers in which he appears, connected to Chaitanya, for them, this statement of Chaitanya was a life mission. And this year we celebrate the 50th anniversary of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. 50 years ago, Srila Prabhupada started ISKCON with a view to connect people to this divine message of Chaitanya, this divine message of loving Krishna. And many of us who have gathered here today have experienced in our own way this journey of Lord Chaitanya's message and the love for Krishna that he speaks about. But this evening I want, and I promise I will very shortly, hand over. Well, you asked me to give an introduction.
Yeah, an introduction.
And my introduction is coming to an end. Are you happy with introduction, is it? And this evening, we're going to share a very personal journey of Mary. A journey that started before Krishna Bhanti even opened. And in the early years of Krishna Bhanti being open, that journey of exploring the life of Chaitanya and the message of Chaitanya started to grow on Mary. And then, by Chaitanya's grace, Mary became the principal at the school. And Mary will share with us insights and their appreciation of Chaitanya in a very real way by serving at the school and what that means to you as a devout Christian. So there, that's the end of my introduction. Let us welcome Mary Lawson.
My journey
very different.
Yeah. Well, maybe 6:30 is 7:30. So, for those people here who don't know me, or you may just have seen me around, maybe. I've been a committed Christian for all of my adult life, and I've been involved in the education of children for about as long. I've taught in a wide variety of schools, independent, secondary, primary, and academy free. I was also director of education for the Diocese of Leicester until I joined the Krishnavati Primary School. Relatively early in my career, I recognized that faith was very important to me and that I only felt content in a school where there was space and encouragement for open discussions about God, what I call God talk. Although I have been predominantly in Christian environments, I've also always encouraged exploration and comparisons of all faith. It is important that as teachers and parents, we show our children the awe and wonder of our world that God has created for us all. All schools, and especially those with a faith foundation, are about allowing our children and our communities to grow and flourish academically, but also spiritually, like plants they need to be nourished and cared for. Of all the places I have worked and taught in, Krishnavati is the place where I became most at ease with my own faith by having very deep discussions and explorations of faith with parents and with some of the children. I remember not so long ago, Dan, you all interviewed me, year three, they interviewed me about my faith, and one of the things I asked them was, did they mind that I was a Christian leading worship? And they said no. You may ask me then, why is that? Why was I at ease mostly with my Christian faith in Krishnavati? And also, how did I come to know about this enigma, Sri Chaitanya? As I've alluded to already, my own journey to his discovery has been a bit unorthodox and perhaps just random coincidence. Or perhaps it was something else, something much bigger. When I started at the school, I wondered how could I possibly understand the faith of Krishnavati. It was so far removed from where I was. Endless discussions, endless questions. Sometimes answered, sometimes not. How could I possibly lead the expression of faith in such a school, as I believe it as principal, I should lead on that element too. It was a daunting project prospect. In fact, no. Instead, my journey of discovery has been a truly wonderful time of learning for me. Well, that journey or quest started on the main stairs in our school, because hanging on the wall is an enormous painting of this remarkable man. But who was this person, Sri Chaitanya? It wasn't a name that I'd ever heard of before. other than saying who he was, no one really enlightened me as to why he was there in such prominence in our school. So I went to the font of all modern knowledge. Not pretty, but went to Google. But Google didn't help because they had never heard of him. So I asked and I listened and I just discussed with Pretty with loads and loads and loads of questions. Then one day I met a man who came to school, Rancho Prime, the author of this brilliant book here, The Birth of Kirtan. He sat in my office one afternoon discussing his journey as well as my own to date. As I began to learn more about Sri Chaitanya, I began to make these comparisons alongside the life of Jesus. Whether you are a Christian or a Hindu Vaishnava, the similarities are really quite amazing. To begin with, both Jesus and Chaitanya's births had been foretold in scripture of God descending to earth. They both spent just a short time dwelling amongst mankind on earth. They wrote no books, but they left rich legacies of teachings and prayers for us all. As Chaitanya said, I give my teachings to all and live by what I teach. And we've had this written over the archway to the Shrine of School, as I really wanted the children to see and to remember that phrase. These are verses left by Chaitanya, but I've taken them from this book. It's a lot easier to understand. He said, my friends, chanting God's name is the best spiritual path. Glory be to our chanting Krishna's name, which washes the dust of years from the mirror of the heart, extinguishes the blazing fire of birth and death, spreads the shining moon of good fortune, and inspires true wisdom. This chanting expands the ocean of bliss and gives all who bathe in that ocean a taste of the sweetest nectar at every step. Oh my Lord, your many, many names contain all your personal potencies, and there are no rules of how and when to chant. Your mercy is so great, yet my misfortune is that I have no attraction for your names. One who feels lower than the grass, who is more tolerant than a tree, who expects no personal honor, but gives all honor to others, can easily chant the name of the Lord constantly. If a tree is mistreated, it still gives fruit, it still gives shelter without protesting or even asking for water. As Chaitanya spoke, his humility grew and he prayed for the gift of service. O Supreme Lord, I have no desire to enjoy wealth or fame or a beautiful partner. All I want birth after birth is to offer you pure devotional service. O Krishna, I am your eternal servant, but I have fallen into this ocean of birth and death. Please be merciful and accept me as a particle of dust at your lotus feet. Saying these prayers, he felt the deep desire to chant Krishna's name in ecstatic love and continued, when all tears stream from my eyes, words falter in my throat, and my hair stand on end by chanting your name. A moment seems like a thousand years. Tears flow from my eyes like torrents of rain. All the world appears vacant without you, Govinda. He remembered Radha's words, a day never ends, my eyes relive clouds of the monsoon. I am burning in a slow fire. Krishna ignores me to test my love. My friends say I should forget him, but I cannot. Absorbed in Radharani's mood, he spoke from his heart. Let Krishna embrace me as I fall at his feet, or trample me beneath him, or let him even break my heart by leaving me. He is free to do anything and everything, for he will always be the unconditional Lord of my heart. Chaitanya Chaitanya and Jesus both had relatively small groups of disciples or devotees. As you see, as I read, every new piece of information filled me with wonder. And the real question for me now is, why don't we all know about Chaitanya and his disciples? I've never, ever heard of his name, ever. I even spoke to Bishop Tim about it, asking him, did he know his name? Ramshaw Prime gave me a copy of this book, The Birth of Kirtan. And if anybody really wants to have a read of it, it's such a, not having that one now. But it's so easy to read, and it just filled me with wonder. He gave me a copy of the book, and rather here, I found Chaitanya and his close friends, the Panchatattva, the five truths. I discovered that 500 years ago, Advaita Acharya saw the world as it was, how the people had lost their way, and this brought him great despair at what he saw. Every day he sat and prayed to the Lord to come to earth and guide people along the path back to his love. So what did Chaitanya do? Well, he ignited a spiritual revolution. He defied the superficial, oppressive, and sectarian boundaries of his time by declaring that pure love of Krishna, God, is the privilege of all souls, regardless of their caste or station in life, regardless of their faith. He taught and explained how this love inspires compassion for all beings. He proclaimed the precious treasure of his love is within our hearts, and every single person is entitled to it. He taught that God has many names, each of them empowered to awaken the dormant love within our hearts. He fearlessly confronted prejudice of the oppressive caste system. He said that sincere, loving intent was all that mattered, not the material value of things. Chaitanya extended his mercy equally from kings to stray dogs. And one qualification is to open your heart to accept his grace. Jesus did the same. He proclaimed there are two commandments, not ten, two. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Do this and you will live. There are so many similarities between the teachings of both men. Pandit means learned one. Sri Chaitanya and Jesus Christ then were learned ones. Their example is alike to any of us in this world want to take up a serious practice of spiritual life. Jesus' message is no different from the message preached in another time and place by Lord Chaitanya. It would be a great shame if we allowed our Hinduism, our Islam, our Judaism, or our Christianity to stand in the way of being able to follow God. Chaitanya and Christ, then, are they the same or are they different? God is one, and he is supreme. Although he is one, he is addressed by several names. Lord Chaitanya has said, God has millions and millions of names, because there's no difference between God's name and himself. Each one of these names has the same potency as God. Christ is another name for Krishna. Prabhupada explained that Christ comes from the Greek word Christos, and Christos is the Greek version of Krista. And when we call on Krishna, he often says Krista. Krista is a Sanskrit word meaning the object of attraction. So when we address God as Christ, Krista, or Krishna, we indicate the same all-attractive Supreme Personality of Godhead. When Jesus said, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Father, meaning God, God of all, Krishna. Christ is simply another way of saying Krista, and Krista is another way of pronouncing Krishna. Then we would find that the Supreme Person, our Father, is one, and every other person in this world are our brothers and our sisters. We would then shun violence, divorce hatred, and live together as obedient children of God. Jesus Christ wanted to spread his message of brotherhood, for which he voluntarily suffered and died. Lord Chaitanya said, whoever can impart knowledge about Krishna is a spiritual master. A genuine spiritual master simply tries to get people to become devotees of God. He has no other business. I believe that the severe persecution of all those who followed Jesus at that time caused Christianity to go underground for a long time and become a quieter faith, involving silent prayer and contemplation. Whereas with Chaitanya, well, he just burst out of his house into the streets chanting God's name, Krishna, over and over and over, to reach such ecstasy and shed tears. This was the birth of Kirtan. A question now. What does Kirtan action mean? What does it actually do? Well, for a time in school, I found it difficult to understand. I followed and was very much on the side of everyone. Gradually, however, I thirsted for ways to chant, to change the usual. And thanks to Chamni and Sachin, weekly practice and their belief that I could actually lead Kirtan. Every week we practice for an hour after school. This took such a lot of courage on my part, but it began to grow, and the kirtan became a joyous expression of love to the Lord that I too experienced and felt its power. I have thought long and hard about kirtan, having missed it so very much, and have hungered for it over these past months.
You don't have to apologize for anything.
In 2009, I was fortunate to be in Canterbury Cathedral. Fortunately, because the Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. Rowan Williams, was there giving three evening talks on prayer. Now, I'm really not one for attending or listening to religious lectures at all, but I was curious, and he is a captivating speaker, and of course, he's Welsh. Here was a man, the Archbishop of Canterbury, with authority and knowledge, speaking about the seven stages of prayer. How we begin with talking to God, chatting, and gradually may be able to speak with others about our faith and become more confident in our faith. Maybe spend some time on retreat. This would take us to about stage 4 or 7. But he says, this is where most people get stuck, unable to move forward from that point. From here, the feeling is, well, I've done my bit, now it's over to you, God, you do something. He talked about finding a hook, a phrase, or a prayer that can be repeated over and over so that your mind is more focused. Suggested the Jesus prayer, or the word Maranatha, the Aramaic word meaning Lord come, and to say it as you breathe out, Maranatha, Maranatha, although I did it in silence. The chant takes you away from the attachment of things of this world, those bindings loosened so that God can come in. state of profoundly letting go of the material world, lose the grip of the things we want that make us comfortable, as God wants our hearts to expand with His truth, so we see God's glory in ordinary things, and God wants us to rejoice in life and know that we're not alone. He said, this is the Archbishop of Canterbury, chanting is like a formula to keep you anchored, a mantra that allows your heart to be open, stopping concentration on yourself, so that the energy of God permeates mind, body and heart all together. So I suppose you would call that Christian kirtan.
Yeah.
I wish I had asked him about Lord Chaitanya, if I'd known about Lord Chaitanya then. Returning to Sri Chaitanya, his teaching is to proclaim the awe and wonder of God in a loud and joyous way. People were captivated by his singing. His teaching was to love Krishna, and this pure love should inspire compassion for all life on earth. It is by living and showing God's love that we are transformed. So I went and had to think about the Bible. And there's a wonderful psalm in the Bible, Psalm 100, that starts with, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with singing." And it goes on, "Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise, and be thankful unto him, and bless his name." So even Christians can be loud sometimes. In my experience, I've never, never felt closer to God than when I've been in school, chanting with the children and stuff.
Closer to God than when I have been in school chanting with the children and staff proclaiming our love for the Lord together.
This is my own journey and my own personal reflections, and from someone who has been humbled and enlightened by a Sri Chaitanya.
Let us all chant Hare Krishna. Thank you. Samaria's going to stay for a short while. We are serving a meal next door, so please stay and join us for that. But do come up and meet with Mary and Joseph. Thank you all very much for coming.